So welcome all to the instruction course glaucoma suspect. And glaucoma suspects are not uncommon to find. Their clinical dilemma, and we have to think when we will going to start the treatment. That is the topic of our discussion. The unnecessary intervention can lead to decreased quality in life. However, certain cases can progress to overt glaucoma if left untreated. So we have to balance very delicately between these two things, whether to treat or not treat. And presence of certain risk factors and clinical findings can tilt the scale towards treatment initiation. Through this course, we are going to discuss when to initiate the treatment. We have very experienced glaucoma consultants in our panel who are going to give us some hints of when to start the treatment. So we are going to start the treatment. Our first speaker is Dr. Professor P.K. Nanda. He is going to tell us who a glaucoma suspect is. He is a very senior glaucoma consultant. He is in the HOD of the High Tech Medical College, and he is the first speaker of this topic, and he is going to give the who is the glaucoma suspect is. So over to Professor Nanda. Let him discuss. Dr. Nanda, you can.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Professor Sumita. Good afternoon. Thank you, Professor Sumita, for giving me this opportunity to talk on this instruction course, along with the great glaucoma specialist like Professor J.C. Das, Manish, Deepak, Pratif, and Rita. Coming to my topic, it is who is a glaucoma suspect? So, a glaucoma suspect is an individual with clinical findings and or a constellation of risk factors that indicate an increased likelihood of developing glaucoma. They do not definitely have glaucoma at present, but are at higher risk of developing glaucoma in future compared to others based on a variety of factors. Can be open angle glaucoma or a closed angle glaucoma.
Sir, please.
Am I audible to all?
Yes, sir.
Sir, I request you to share your
PPT. Okay. The is it okay now?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So in glaucoma suspect, they do not definitely have glaucoma, but at present, they are not glaucomatous patient, but they are suspicious of glaucoma. So it revolves around three mechanisms, either raised IOP, visual field defect, or optic nerve problems, or RNFL defects. One or more of the following in at least one eye is very important. IOP consistently 21 millimeter of mercury are high in applanation. Optic disc appearance suggestive of glaucomatous cropping. Appearance of the disc, there is a difference in both the eyes of more than 0.2. Diffused or localized abnormalities of RNFL. Visual field suspicious for early glaucomatous damage. Occludable angle more than 180 degree in iridotrabecular contacts. With normal IOP and no optic nerve damage can also suggest of angle closure glaucoma. How glaucoma suspects are identified? It can be identified with ocular or non-ocular causes, either in the diabetic retinopathy or on medication of SCQ, steroid, ethambutol, for their drug toxicity or screening of the family members because first generation family members are most prone. Risk factor developing glaucoma consistently high IOP more than 30, thin central corneal thickness, CD ratio more than 0.7, older age groups, visual field has to be noted, exfoliation or pigment dispersion syndrome, optic disc hemorrhages are family history. Additional factors suspicious of disc appearance, myopia, and low nerve perfusion pressure, where the diastole blood pressure minus IOP is to be taken, and steroid responders. Systemic that might increase the optic nerve damage are also in African races and obstructive sleep apnea. Now it is coming up, obstructive sleep apnea, glaucoma suspects are more. Diabetes, hypertension, cardiovascular diseases, thyroid, myopia, all prone for this. Patient history with patients should be always noted. Ocular history, because the history of trauma the patient may miss sometimes. Family history is most important because our first degree of children, parents, sons and daughters, they are more prone from glaucoma. So history of ocular surgery is also important. Cataract surgery may lower the IOP. LASIK, SMILE, PRK can be associated with falsely IOP measurement due to corneal thinning. So all the time, tachymetry readings should be re-entered in the record. Previous collagen cross-linking for keratoconus, the results are in corneal chipping, leading to increased and false reading of eye apprehension. Initial glaucoma suspects evaluation. Progressive change in optic nerve or visual field is the definite feature of glaucoma. To detect any change of IOP or optic nerve visual field status should be noted. Baseline documentation is very important. Documentation in all cases should be important, all whether in cornea, glaucoma, medical legal cases, documentation is very essential in our profession. So ocular hypertension, lowering of elevated IOP reduces the risk of developing glaucomatous visual field. Preferably, apprehension tonometer should be used. Diurnal variation and its peak should be noted. Inter-eye asymmetry should be noted specially. Central corneal thickness is very important because the POAG is greater in eyes with less than 515 micron, or it is eyes having corneal thickness of 588 micron. So thinner corneas underestimate the IOP, while thicker corneas overestimate the corneal edema. Both static and dynamic gonioscopies should be done, but only one thing you have to highlight, that tonometry should be done before gonioscopy, because after gonioscopy, if we do tonometry, then that gives a false reading. As usual, we have to note all the details. Optic nerve head, slit lamp evaluation with 70 to 90 degree lenses, we can say. Color stereo photography of optic nerve head has to be done. Handwriting with relevant details to be written. Imaging of optic nerve head, RNFL defect, macular for ganglion cell analysis should also be done. Few example here I am to quote, because the contour cupping and color cupping gives right to misconception of a cup, but here the diversion of the blood vessels is more important. Here the inferior thinning, and here the neuroretinal thinning is more important. Here in the disc hemorrhage is shown only in photographs, which we may miss in clinical finding. So visual field, as usual, we have to do standard optometry perimetry at 24 to 10 true depths. Frequency of doubling technology and shortwave automated perimetry can detect glaucomatous changes earlier than SAP. For example, in a case here, you just note, vision is 6x6, 20x20 with -4.5 diopters. If patient is myopic, intraocular pressure is 13 and 14, corneal thickness 5 and 30, and the CD ratio is 0.8. So it is a case of, even the gonio is an open angle, and it is a suspected case of glaucoma suspect. Here is another example where the patient is a diabetic and the brother is operated for glaucoma. So we have to suspect, even the IOP is 24 and 25, we have to think of the glaucoma suspect. Here in this case, the notch in the superior neuroretinal rim is very important, corresponding the RNFL defect. IOP in normal range, standard optometry perimetry and vision risk suspect and monitor can be done. So to conclude, periodic checkup is necessary in glaucoma suspects to monitor the progression. If signs of definite conversion to glaucoma detected, treatment should be initiated, because in the normal and in glaucoma patients, there is a thin rim of transitional zone where we miss the whether to treat or not to treat. If we treat, it will be exaggerated. If we do not treat, we may land up in patient with a glaucoma, which may give rise to problem or blindness or to the patient and to the doctor also. Thank you everybody for a patient hearing. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, Professor Nanda, for finishing it before time and within 6 minutes only. Then we'll, next speaker is Dr. Deepak Mishra. Has he arrived?
I cannot see Dr. Deepak here. Can we move ahead with the other speaker? Dr. Sumita, you are on mute. We cannot hear you.
Okay, sorry. Dr. Manish, next speaker is Dr. Manish. Has he come?
No, ma'am. Dr. Manish Singh is also not there in the meeting.
Then we'll finish the keynote address of what?
We can start with the other speaker also, Dr. Rita.
Jayant, are you there? Dr. Jayant? I'm sorry to interrupt. The keynote speaker, Dr. Jayant, are you there? Logged in?
Yes. Hi, how are you? Amit? Hello.
Yeah, fine, Jayant. So we can take the keynote first, Jayant, if you're logged in.
Oh, yes. So mine is a pre-recorded talk, so you can just play it, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Yeah. So, problem. Go for yeah. It. So if they're waiting for the speakers,
you can play
then you can start with the keynote address.
Swapnila? Yes, we can begin with that.
So please play the keynote. Swapnila, to get the AV team to play the keynote.
Happy to hear everyone's opinions after that and have a discussion. Go for
Hello, everyone. It's my pleasure to be with you at the AIOC 2021, albeit virtually. I'd like to thank Dr. Amit Powal and Dr. Partha Biswas and the AIOS Scientific Committee for inviting me to talk about catching the thief of sight, detection and management of glaucoma in a large-scale setting where adherence compliance may be a problem. I have no financial disclosure specific to this talk or relevant to this talk. Scope of the talk is this, really. There's no definition of the disease. How do we detect it? What exactly is glaucoma? What's the current status of the disease? What are the strategies to detect and manage this disease? So is there any point defining a disease? So about 30 years ago, when glaucoma was not defined, it was not even listed as a cause of blindness on many official publications of the WHO, because as one expert stated, if it can't be defined or treated, it's not on the list. And a few years later, when they actually applied definitional criteria to various epidemiological studies, they found glaucoma to be the second leading cause of blindness. The current definition that is widely used comes from a paper 20 years back by Foster et al. That specifically looks at the clinician grading of the nerve head. For example, Koblis ratio of more than 0.7 or disc asymmetry of more than 0.2 with associated characteristic visual field defect is noted to have glaucoma. But the problem with that is it's very subjective. Many studies have shown significant inter and intra-observer discrepancy in Koblis ratio grading. And currently, imaging technology, specifically optical coherence tomography or OCT of the retinal nerve fiber layer, OCT RNFL, is widely available. So what if we were to use this to more objectively define the disease? So a few years ago, my colleagues and I at Wilma Eye Institute and Johns Hopkins conducted a multi-center trial to more objectively define the disease. From data from various centers worldwide, using a consensus definition derived from glaucomatologists worldwide. And we found that if the clinician excluded non-glaucomatous optic neuropathy and maculopathy, and they had each eye had at least two sets of OCT, RNFL, and visual fields performed, and if the eye had matching or corresponding visual field defects and OCT, RNFL defects, that eye has glaucoma, regardless of the visual acuity or the intraocular pressure. And this had a very high sensitivity and specificity. So I think we got a good starting point in objectively defining the disease. So for example, the right eye has a normal OCT and a normal HUF, has no glaucomatous optic neuropathy. The left eye has corresponding OCT and visual field defects. So it has definite glaucomatous optic neuropathy by this definition. Relatively simple and quite easy to use. Now that we have defined the disease, what's the current status? It's the second leading cause of blindness worldwide. 3-4% of the world's population suffers from it. And the worrying part is about 50-90% of those who were found to have glaucoma on screening did not know that they had it or were undiagnosed at pickup. So that's very worrying. But screening is still not recommended by many countries for following reasons. I mean, it has a low relative population prevalence rate, low accuracy of any said screening test, so it's not found to be cost effective. But these guidelines are being revisited in various countries because it may be effective in high-risk populations, perhaps those with a positive family history of glaucoma, or those who are living in areas or with populations where they have minimal or low access to eye care or healthcare in general. These patients may benefit from targeted screening strategies. There's also a general lack of awareness of the disease. So many people who are detected to have glaucoma don't go for further follow-up because they feel they are seeing well. There's also a shortage of resources in managing the condition. In addition, glaucoma is a complex disease to screen and manage. They need multiple tests to diagnose and manage it even within a tertiary eye center. So there's no large-scale national program at the moment to screen for the disease. However, there are many targeted screening strategies that are ongoing. For example, in India, Aravind Eye Hospital performs screening of first-degree relatives, or they also perform opportunistic screening of those who come through their door for glaucoma. In Singapore, we screen through fundus photography images for those who are undergoing fundus photography screening because they have diabetes. And if they have any suspicion of glaucoma based on the optic nerve head on the photo, then they are referred on for further care. And these strategies help us alleviate the burden of the disease a little bit. So ideal screening strategies should be hopefully less labor intensive. Hopefully we have better and more portable screening tests. And hopefully there's increased awareness of the condition in the population through better education. So we have a few strategies that we are working on to come up with screening tools for the disease. Dan Mealy and colleagues in Surrey are looking at using a pupillometer to assess pupillary response to light in detecting early glaucoma. This is because glaucoma causes loss of intrinsically photosensitive retinal ganglion cells. And when they found that there's reduced pupil constriction when exposed to monochromatic blue or red light in early stage glaucoma, they figured this could be a potential easy tool to use in the future. Right now, the tool is however very chunky, not portable, and this is still in its research phase. But this is something I'll watch out for. It could be an interesting strategy. Another thing is many centers already have optical coherence tomography. So one way would be to optimize currently available strategy. And Leopold Schmetterer, Jacqueline Chua, and colleagues are looking into this. Currently, OCR-NFL has a lower discriminatory performance in early disease, and that could be due to inadequate normative database and other anatomical factors such as myopia-related disc tilt and retinal vessel density. So they're coming up with a software, or they come up with a software to optimize the following factors like ethnicity, age, refractive error, distance between the fovea and the optic disc. And when they applied that, they found that they could detect glaucoma better. So really, their strategy rests in detecting glaucoma from currently available technology and augmenting it with better software. Artificial intelligence is another area I'll be really looking out for in helping us better detect and manage the disease. It purports to be less labor intensive, may resolve access to care issues, may be cost effective. And we are specifically looking at deep learning networks that can handle high dimensional data such as fundus images, or optical coherence tomography images, and even whole loads of perimetry data that our human mind may not be able to deal with, and be able to delineate into whether the eye has glaucoma or not. We have done studies in Singapore Eye Research Institute looking at fundus images from various countries, various ethnicities, to look out for various conditions, including referable glaucoma suspect from these fundus images. And after training the deep learning system, we found that to be a very respectable area under the curve in detecting referable glaucomatous optic neuropathy when comparing against gold standard grading by the graders or by the ophthalmologists. This study results also corroborated by other studies in China. And AI is also looking at augmenting detecting glaucoma from just an OCT image. So we are looking at fundus images. We're also looking at OCT images. We have a group in Singapore that's looking into this, looking at better image augmentation of currently acquired OCT images, and then using AI to determine whether that eye has a high probability or low probability or no probability of glaucomatous optic neuropathy. So this could be an interesting strategy where we just look at one tool, optimize it, and then use AI to help us detect whether the eye has a high or low probability of glaucomatous optic neuropathy. So this could be a very effective screening strategy. So AI may over time improve the workflow and efficiency in our glaucoma service. For example, a primary eye care provider could feed the deep learning system with fundus photos or OCT images or perimetry data. And that system could then classify it as either likely glaucoma, not glaucoma, or not classifiable. And then not glaucoma can be discharged, and the likely glaucoma and not classifiable may be reviewed by the clinician. What about treatment options? So when you have glaucoma, what next? Eye drops would be the easiest, but and it's also least invasive, but it needs compliance and adherence. There are side effects. You need regular follow-up and regular uptake of eye drops for life. So there's a challenge, especially in larger population groups. SLT, a selective laser trabeculostomy, has shown promise, especially in a recent light trial. It has relatively good efficacy in open-angle glaucoma. It may be one off, but there are costs associated with it, and you need a certain skill set to be able to perform SLT. But this is one strategy that could be employed and is already being looked at in various parts of sub-Saharan Africa. Early cataract surgery, not just for mature cataract, as many of our cataract camps are concentrating in countries like India. This could be useful in alleviating the burden of angle closure disease. It improves vision. And also, you can use this as an opportunistic screening mechanism, system to screen for other eye diseases. However, it needs expertise, and there are potential blinding complications from cataracts as well. MIGS, trabeculectomy, and tube surgery may not be ideal candidates in a large-scale setup where follow-up and adherence is not easy. Summary, our wish list is better population awareness, better one-stop portable screening tools, better management strategies that are less reliant on patient adherence. So in summary, I would say targeted and opportunistic screening approach may be useful in alleviating the burden of glaucoma. New technology, specifically AI, might be useful in the near future in helping us better detect and monitor the disease. With regards to treatment strategies, we could consider expanding the role of selective laser trabeculoplasty and even doing earlier cataract surgeries, not just for those hypermature and mature as we focus on in many of our cataract camps, but even any vision cataract that affects vision, we should consider doing cataract surgery at an earlier stage to restore good eyesight and also perform opportunistic screening for other eye conditions. With that, I thank you very much.
Thank you very much for having me, everyone. Basically, I thought I'll present some ideas. I won't take too much of your time because I know we are rushing, but I'm very looking forward to any centers that are willing to collaborate. We have AI-specific tools that are helping us manage or detect glaucoma at an earlier stage in Singapore that's developed and in the US that I have access to. I would love to collaborate with centers in India, not just Aravind. So I thought I'll just make a pitch out there. And anyone has any ideas to solve this problem out? You know, 90% of glaucoma in India is undiagnosed, and we need to take a crack at it. And there are modalities we can use. So it's my privilege to be here, although virtually. Thank you, Amit, for inviting me. And I won't take more of your time. Please go ahead with the rest of the program unless you have any other comments. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Iyer.
Thank you.
My next speaker is Dr. Deepak Misra. He's going to deal with the very controversial topic of how much IOP is better for a patient and when to start the treatment, how high a pressure. Dr. Deepak Misra, to start the screen sharing.
Thank you, ma'am. My slides, please.
Yeah, not yet. Now it has come. Make it slides one.
Yeah. Thanks. Thanks to EIVS and Professor Sutra ma'am for giving me this opportunity. There is no financial interest in it. First of all, why we have to find out which IOP is safe in the glaucoma? The answer lies itself by knowing the basic understanding of the disease, like whatever the vision loss has occurred in glaucoma is permanent, and most of the time the patient is unaware that he or she is having glaucoma because central vision is preserved. So one of the things that patient is not aware that his vision is lost, and second, whatever the vision lost is permanent. It is not like cataract or something else that we can reverse it. And third, like our country, which is a big country and have fewer literacy rates. So awareness is also a problem, that if anyone has been diagnosed or treating glaucoma, then how we can counsel them properly so that they can manage or do the drugs and everything for lifetime. Next, for the IOP, since IOP is the only thing which is important and modifiable risk factor, so we have to know what IOP is important to treat and how we can go for that. For that, we have to know and measure of the major glaucoma studies and already shown that lowering effect of IOP helps in rapid production of the reduction in the progress of the disease. So the answer lies is the target pressure, means we have something pressure range where we can reverse, or it is not reverse, we can retard the progression of the visual field. And remember that this target pressure is not a range of pressure, it is an individualized pressure. It is not a common pressure that, yes, this pressure is applied for each and everyone. For that, we have to know what is the initial pressure, what is the stage of the disease, what is the life expectancy of the disease, what is the rate of damage, race, corneal thickness, family history. There are various parameters which can tell us that which is the target pressure for which individual. I am again saying it is an individualized, it is not a fixed thing for generalized population. And when we go for there, then there is a target pressure formulas, various formulas are there, but this one is in 2004 and it is almost accepted everywhere, where we have the target pressure is equal to the initial pressure upon this circulation. This equation is there, and there is a Z is corresponding to different types of the severity of the disease. I am not going in detail of this, just to know that yes, target pressure is calculated how individually. I am showing this formula. Another thing is, this is from the European Glaucoma Society guideline. Whenever you have suspect, when we have a high target pressure and we have a low target pressure, first is the damage. When the damage is early, then we can have a pressure of the higher range. But when damage is advanced, then we have a lower pressure. Second is the life expectancy. Life expectancy is very much important. Like if any, it is, now we are seeing the juvenile glaucoma and other glaucomas are going on. So life expectancy is such thing which we have some important, that we have to know what is the life expectancy. If life expectancy is more, then we have to target higher pressure. So here. Now, which is safe and where we can know that which is safe. These are the various randomized controlled trials which can tell us which pressure is, how this pressure has evolved to retard the progression. One of the important is ocular hypertension trial, in which we have a target of IOP less than 24 mm of Hg, and the minimum reduction was the 20% from the baseline. And we found that after, when we have converted reduced it to 20%, then the treatment, when the, in the treated group, only the 4.4% people have progressed to open angle glaucoma, and in non-treating there is 9.5%. So a lower IOP reduces the risk of progression of glaucoma. Another study is based on the aggressive management to control the visual field loss and the reduction. And we found that both either medical or surgical method, we can reduce, although there is better control by the medical method than the surgical method in the, when we have compared with the regard to progression of the disease. And this is the normal tension study group, in which we have a target that in normal tension, IOP is normal. So there was a question that whether we have to reduce IOP in that too or not. So the, that answer comes from the, this study of the NTG. Here we have to reduce the 30% of the pressure from the baseline and find out that the eyes that progress into the further, we have 35% who are untreated, and those we have a 30% reduction from the baseline from the normal, only 12% has progressed. Same thing is demonstrated by the EGIS study. It is different that what we have to know, and it is a 5-year study plan where we have to know that those patients who achieve lower IOP constantly have lesser chance of the progression. In this field, you can see here that the pressure ranges and the rate of the progression is detected. In as soon as the pressure is increases, the progression is also the increasing, the decrease in the visual fields. Early manifest glaucoma studies also tell us that the IOP, when even the 1 mm decrease in the IOP leads to the decrease the risk of progression to 10%. And apart from these, I am coming to the conclusion of all these 4 studies. Most important thing is lowering IOP is important, no matter how much type of glaucoma patient have. Another one, as we see, each millimeter of mercury is important. So don't think that it's a range we can treat, and the treatment should be effective, safe, and tolerable. But again, all these are the theoretical things. We have something, we need some numbers. Like we have to counsel the patient, then we have to say, yes, which type of percentage or what is the baseline or from where, from IOP from today we have to reduce so that you can have some benefit. And the answer lies here in the AO guideline. Here they have given a simple guideline that if we have a glaucoma which is of mild grade, means only optic nerve changes, but there is no field loss, then the reduction is from 20 to 30% is ideal for them. Those who have advanced glaucoma, means having visual field changes too, then there is reduction of 40 or 40% more from the baseline. In cases of NTG, 30% reduction from the baseline. In cases of ocular hypertension, there is 20% reduction from the baseline. And these three are the similar which we always remember to keep the pressure. If visual field is advanced, if disease is advanced, then put the IOP in the range of lower teens. If it is moderate, then mid-teens. If high, then the if visual field is mild, then give it IOP at higher range. So from all these, we have to know. Yes, I am concluding. From all these, we have to know that there is no fixed IOP. That is very important feature, that there is no fixed IOP for everyone. IOP has to be individualized based on the risk factor or life expectancy, the stage of the disease, and a proper IOP control and care is very important to prevent these eyes from the damage, because it is glaucoma is not a one thing that if you anyone is not putting drug for 1 or 2 or 3 days, then anything happened. It is a lifelong process to put the eye drops, and every time the effect is seen in a longer term. And since central vision is preserved, so patient is still unaware that they are having reduction of the field. With these comments, I am like to thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak. Very short time, you adjusted it very beautifully. Next, my speaker is Dr. Monis, is going to talk about the angle closure suspects. Over to Dr. Monis.
Thank you, madam. Since we are running short of time, I'll just very briefly give an overview about how to manage angle suspects, or rather how to deal with angle suspects. Angle suspects per se is a very broad term. It can be an open angle suspect or a closed angle suspect, but we'll be focusing primarily on primary angle closure suspects. Gonoscopy, as you all know, is very, very important, and a proper gonoscopy can give you a very important insight into the etiology of disease also. If I just share this slide, you can see there are 4 patients with different types of cyanechia. This first patient on the top left, you can see these point cyanechia. Very typically we see in patients with primary angle closure glaucoma. On the right side, you can see these large tent-like cyanechia, often seen in patients with uveitic glaucoma. Lower left side, you have a broad cyanechia with the rest of the angle open, often seen in eye syndrome. On the lower right side, you have large iris strands extending well beyond the solvus line with multiple holes in the iris. These are basically seen in X and Fields wrinkle anomaly. So gonoscopy can give you a lot of insight, not only about the open or close angle, but also in the etiology of the disease. Now, why we were focusing on angle closure? We all know that in India, we have more angle closure glaucoma, but what is more important, that it is a preventable cause of blindness. If you do a gonoscopy timely, you do a PI, most of the patient will never progress to angle closure disease. There have been multiple classifications. The most common, as you all know, the ISGO classification of primary angle closure suspect, primary angle closure, and primary angle closure glaucoma. So suspects are patients where more than 180 degree, you can't see the posterior trabecular meshwork. Rest everything is normal. But when this is associated with other finding like raised IOP or cyanechia, iris atrophy with no disc and field changes, then these are primary angle closure. And when you have additional disc and field changes also, then we call it as a glaucoma. It is important to classify patients in these groups, because unless you do that, you won't be able to manage them correctly, because the approach is different in all the three. It is very important to learn indentation gonoscopy, because here you can differentiate an apposition from a cyanic enclosure. And as we have discussed, presence and absence of cyanechia is extremely important for classifying your patients. Treatment of PAC or PACG is more straightforward. Iridotomy is needed for all patients, even if you have extensive cyanechia. Medical management is similar to primary opening glaucoma, except in plateau iris syndrome, where we will be considering and using pilocarpine. And definitely, we have a lower threshold for cataract extraction. But in case of PACS, whom to do iridotomy, it is still not very clear. In fact, the preferred practice pattern by American Academy has highlighted that there are no completed trials to clearly classify or document the role of iridotomy in PACS. The Valora study has shown that if you don't do iridotomy, only 22% patients with PACS progress to PAC, and none of them actually developed glaucoma. And the more recent ZAP trial also has shown that over a 72 months period, which is 6-year period, Even if you're not doing PI in a patient with PACS, only 7.9 out of 1,000 patients actually progress to PAC. So to prevent one progression, you need to treat 44 patients, which is a very high number needed to treat. So to highlight, definitely not all primary angle closure suspects need iridotomy, but in case the patient has got other acute angle closure attack, you definitely should do iridotomy. Or else if the follow-up is an issue, needs regular dilatation, patient has got some signs, symptom of angle closure or a very strong family history, you should be doing an iridotomy. In other patients, just keep them under follow-up, document your finding. And in future, if you see these patchy pigmentation indicating an iridotrabecular contact or the patient start developing these early synechia, definitely you can go for a iridotomy. So to conclude, suspicious angle, you should have a comprehensive evaluation. Always remember you are treating the patient and not the angle. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Manes, for briefing it so very efficiently and finish it before time also. So we'll get more time for the other speakers. Thank you. And I will be talking about the next topic, that is suspicious.
Hello.
Suspicious visual field. The glaucoma suspect may have some visual field defect or they may not have. If they have some visual field defects, then that may be glaucomatous or maybe not. But we have to, they are not yet conclusive about glaucoma defects. They may be glaucomatous at a certain stage, but still now they are not yet definitely glaucomatous. So if defect of the, some defect we are seeing in the glaucoma field defect, and it appears in any ocular hypertension or in any case of NTG suspect, then that means that the patient has gone up to the angle, the overt glaucoma stage, and treatment should be initiated. So I don't have any financial disclosure to make. So visual field assessment is very much subjective and it should be reliable and reproducible. Otherwise, it should not be taken into account. Never base your diagnosis relying in on only on one visual field. It has to be reproducible and it has to be reliable. Then the reliability criteria, the patient parameters like age, refraction, pupil size, etc. should be entered correctly. And the reliability criteria, fixation loss, false positive and false negative. Out of these three things, false loss, fixation loss can be increased if the mapping is not correct. So in false positive cases is the most important thing, and that should be less than 15 degree. So false positive along with the gaze track monitoring is the most reliable thing to assess the reliability, and proper instructions should be given to the patient before the starting of the perimetry so that patient understands the test and will not make any mistake. If the patient is fatigued or if the patient is inattentive, then we can give the get the cloverleaf pattern, and the reverse cloverleaf will occur if there is the patient does not know that test is started. And another important thing we have to note is that if the defects in the pattern deviation plot is more than the total deviation plot, then that is something is fishy there. If you see the whole printout, you can see that there is lots of white scotomas, and the GST is also showing that abnormally high sensitivity, and the false positive rates are also very high. So that indicates that the patient is trigger happy, and such type of fields should not be taken into consideration. So we have to get two or three good baseline visual fields. If any abnormality is found, that should be confirmed by repeated visual field examination. In ocular hypertensive treatment study also, they have found that abnormalities found in originally abnormal and reliable visual fields were not confirmed on retesting in high as much as 86% of the cases. That shows that most of the time, if you don't repeat it, then the test will be giving a wrong result, and the visual field defects have to be reliable. And they were probably due to learning curve or long-term variability, but the field defects have to be reliable and repeatable so that we can take them into consideration. So criteria for glaucomatous field defects are the abnormal glaucoma hemifield test and 3 or more contiguation points which should be in the abnormal area. An important point is there that it has to be in the typical area for glaucoma like arcuate pattern or paracentral nasal scatter, and the PST should be abnormal and should have a p-value less than 5%. The glaucoma suspects, who are glaucoma suspects, but glaucoma suspects are those in whom one or more of the above signs are present, but where the signs are insufficient for a diagnosis of glaucoma. That means very early glaucoma, but they should be monitored to see the earliest change so that there will not be any permanent vision loss. But other causes of visual field have to be excluded, and field defects should correlate with the clinical picture. Then only we can tell them as glaucomatous defect. So in glaucoma suspects, we have to rely on GHD and the pattern deviation plot, because GHD is so designed that it is very highly specific and sensitive for glaucomatous field defect, and we can track our progression with the MD and BFI. The ocular hypertension treatment study also tells that both the visual field assessment optic disc must be monitored with equal diligence, because either may show the first evidence of glaucomatous damage, and if any visual field damage occurs, then that has to be correlated with the clinical finding, and any subtle change has to be correlated, and then we can initiate treatment. And there is increased risk of developing glaucoma if there is evidence of nasal step, but partial arcuate defect or increased in the pattern standard deviation. So do not overlook central visual field in early glaucoma, because glaucoma may affect the central field ahead than the peripheral field, contrary to the earlier belief. The glaucomatous damage to the macula occurs very early, and some patients may show defects in the centralmost visual field defect. But if we do only 24-2, these points will be missed, because that is not very well represented in the central in the 24-2 parameter. But if we do 10-2, then we can see that it has got 68 points, then up to 1 degree, we can see there is any defect. So if you see any single defect in the central most 4 points, then add 10-2 to the test. And considering that the SITA has now developed one program 24-2C, which adds 10 additional test points within the central 10-2 from fixation. And that helps that the patient need not go and do both the test 24-2 and 10-2, and glaucoma suspects who are going to be converted to frank glaucoma can be detected earlier, and this may be useful. Like in this case, there is superior disc hemorrhage and corresponding inferior visual decrease in the sensitivity. So this can be missed if you do only 24-2 alone. So software augmented perimetry and FDT are two other tests which can detect glaucoma earlier and can detect the conversion of the glaucoma suspect to glaucoma earlier. But some also debate this thing, because they may not be earlier than the standard automated perimetry. Then we have to look for atypical features so that they can give us some guidance that the patient may be having some neuro-ophthalmological condition. So any visual field defect which appears suddenly, or which is purely central scotoma, or which is respecting the vertical midline, or the field defect if that is not due to as glaucomatous pattern, or is not correlating with the clinical picture, so raise the suspicion that the patient may be having some neuro-ophthalmological condition, and we have to investigate in that line. So we should not overlook the retina also. If there is any PRP scar or any scar due to the choroidal abnormalities, then that can produce field defects like glaucoma. So don't give any diagnosis or looking at the perimetry. And the vascular occlusion and retinitis pigmentosa also can produce glaucoma-like defect. And dilated fundus examination is very much essential. To conclude, progression of the visual field defect is a hallmark sign of conversion to glaucoma. So generally, glaucoma suspects have converted to early glaucoma once classic visual field appear, even if the IOP is not increased and they are not attributable to any other pathology. This change we have to monitor very carefully so that patient will not land up having any permanent visual loss, and appropriate treatment at this stage should be initiated. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr.
My next speaker is Dr. Rita Das. He is going to tell us about the optic nerve changes. Dr. Rita Das.
Am I audible?
Yeah, yeah. Start sharing your screen.
Is it visible?
No, no, not yet.
Is it visible?
Not yet.
Yep, that's it, sharing. Is it visible?
No, no, not yet.
My topic is optic disc changes that suggest the treatment initiation. I don't have any financial disclosure. That's
complete. Slides are not coming yet. You're not sharing the screen. Share screen button in the green is there. You make it open.
You first open your PPT desktop and go to share in the screen.
So just to guide you, ma'am, you have to
open the it's visible in my screen.
Then again, push the button share screen. It may be visible.
Ma'am, you can start the next presentation. Meanwhile, the backend team will call up Dr. Rita.
Let Dr. Pradeep
back. Swapnila, please call Dr. Rita and help her. Till then, you can take the next presentation.
Dr. Pradeep can talk. We'll tell Dr. Pradeep. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Will you share your screens? He's going to tell us about the OCT diagnosis. He's a very senior consultant and from the Center for Sight in the Indore. And he's going to talk about the OCT.
Hi, good evening, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Sumita, for having given me this opportunity to speak on this platform. And I would be speaking on the role of OCT, the early diagnosis of glaucoma, that is a glaucoma suspect. Can you see my screen?
No, sir.
Oh.
Yes, sir.
Starting up, sir.
Yeah, yeah. It is coming. No, not yet.
And my screen is visible.
Okay. Is it there? Can you see my screen?
Now. Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah. Now it has come. Please make it slide so. And
yeah.
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay, so I would be talking on the role of imaging in glaucoma suspect. So what is the standard definition of glaucoma? All of us knows that it's a glaucomatous optic neuropathy with the correlating visual field changes. But in the all these visual field changes appear whenever there is more than 30% of ganglion cells are lost. But you can pick up these defects very early by doing a good clinical examination. Even when there are not even 30% ganglion cells are lost, you can see over here that there is an inferotemporal RNFL defect. And here again, there is an inferotemporal RNFL defect. But in both cases, the white on white perimetry was normal. So what is the problem? Why we need the additional equipment? We need the additional equipment because we have to quantify this because glaucoma is a chronic progressive disease. And obviously, we have to monitor it over a period of time. You look at this. There is hardly a splinter defect over here. So might not have even lost 5% of the ganglion cell. And that's why the white on white fields is normal. But all of us knows that there is a splinter hemorrhage and a splinter RNFL defect. So this patient has to be a glaucoma patient. But still, my white on white perimetry was not able to pick up. So there are lots of problems with the perimetry. Number one, it's a subjective test. And number two, it picks up the defect only when at least 30% of the ganglion cells are lost. And apart from that, so many things are required. The patient should be educated. He should be well versed and familiar. And he should not have any other condition where he should not be able to, or she should not be able to perform the visual field test. So there is a quest for an objective test where we can quantify and monitor the defect in the very early stage. And the answer is the imaging technology. So the imaging technology available to our armamentarium are the OCT, GDX, and the HRT. But unfortunately, the GDX and the HRT are no more there. The manufacturer have stopped manufacturing them. So we would be discussing about the OCT. The advantage of the OCT is that it can image the macula, it can image the arcuate nerve fiber layer bundle, and it can image the optic nerve head. And what these three are the most important parameters for glaucoma. And this is what we print out. We get the disc parameters, we get the RNFL thickness map, where we can assess that what how much is the RNFL thickness has been lost in that particular patient. And yes, we do have the progression analysis as well, which does the linear progression analysis for the glaucomatous defect. But another important hallmark feature of this OCT is that they are able to image ganglion cell complex, the GCC. Why GCC is so important? Because almost 30% of the ganglion cells are lies in the glaucoma cell complex. And you can see that they are able to pick up the glaucomatous defect. And over a period of time, you can assess the progression as well. Now, I would like to give you some example. See, this is the first example. You can see that both the disc and there is a little asymmetry. This cup is vertically enlarged, but RNFL looks okay. You can see that the OCT image, and there is a suspicious OCT RNFL loss over here. But on white perimetry, it was absolutely normal. So because it does not fall into the standard definition of the glaucoma, because white on white perimetry was normal, so we did not start the treatment. And look at what has happened. A couple of years later, same patient is presented, and there was a significant mass of the RNFL. You can see over here, there is a significant thinning of the RNFL. You can see there is a significant thinning of the RNFL over here. And yes, there is a superior arcuate stratoma. So that is the importance of the OCT. That is the test which can detect the structural changes in the glaucoma and quantify and can monitor. Look at the other example. This is a one-eyed young lady. White and white perimetry is absolutely normal. And there was a small RNFL defect at 7 o'clock hours. Look at over a period of time, what has happened? There is a broadening of this RNFL defect, and you can see that there was a further dipping of almost 6 micron over here at the single location. So this yellow has turned into red. So obviously this lady has progressed, and there is a clear-cut sign that we must initiate the treatment, so the white-on-white perimetry is normal. The third example, you can see that the white-on-white perimetry is almost normal. But look at here, the same patient. There is a gross papillomacular bundle defect in both the eyes. So all these changes, white and white perimetry is not able to pick up, but yes, certainly, yes, you can pick up by the OCT. But yes, OCT is not absolutely foolproof. Look at here, it's not a tomogram. This, both the discs are looking pretty healthy, just fine 2 and fine 3 cup. But look at here what this tomogram says. You know, I do not have the time to discuss that why there is so much of fallacy. This shows almost a total cup, and this shows that almost horizontally, near total, and vertically also, it's almost 0.4, 0.5 cup. So I don't have enough time, but yes, there is lots of fallacies with OCT as well. So we have to be a little careful about that. You can see that there is an intertest variability. This test was performed. There was significant dry eye. We put the lubricating drop for half an hour, and then again, we performed this test in the same patient. So you can see that there was a significant difference. Okay, and similarly, in the advanced glaucoma, if this patient would have been an advanced glaucomatous patient, then OCT does not have any role because of the floor effect. What is the floor effect? Yes. So that also is beyond the scope of this talk. So I can say in summary that the functional test is the gold standard test, but the functional test cannot be useful in each and every patient and is not capable of picking up the early defect. So we are looking for the test which is objective and which can pick up the structural defect as early as possible. And the OCT is one of them. And obviously, we are looking forward for the OCT for further robust performance. And maybe very soon, we will have the OCT as the gold standard for diagnosing the glaucoma and detecting the progression of glaucoma. Thank you very much for your patience here.
Thank you, sir. I'm afraid that the next two speakers would have only 6 minutes for their presentation. Let us quickly start with the next speaker.
Dr. Rita, can you share your screen?
Sure, ma'am. Is it visible?
Yeah, it has started. Yeah, it is visible. Ma'am, I could slide.
Thank you, ma'am. coming to my topic, it's optic disc suspect. They do not have glaucoma at present, but have high possibility of developing glaucoma. Then what to do when such person comes to us? The dilemma is when observing such a suspicious optic disc. Because there is a high overlap between the normal and the glaucomatous disc, there is great deal of normal and abnormal findings overlap, like a large optic disc with a large cup, like in this picture. So question arises, what is the key factors in an optic disc suspect? The appearance of the optic disc of the retinal nerve fiber layer that is suspicious when there is enlarged vertical cup disc ratio more than 0.7. It's not always 0.7 is abnormal, but these are suspicious things. And asymmetry is the most important thing in glaucoma, that is CD ratio between two eyes more than 0.2, notching of the neuroretinal limb or narrowing disc hemorrhage or retinal nerve fiber layer defect. Coming to this picture, there is a large optic disc, normal optic disc with a 0.7 cropping, which is suspicious. Here is the normal size optic disc with a ISNT pattern broken. The inferior limb is lesser than the superior limb. And here, the both eyes, they are from the same patient. The small optic disc in one eye, the cup is 0.4 and the ISNT pattern is normal and the RNFL looks normal. But in the other eye, there is a deep cupping around 0.8. With careful observation, this can be observed, and there is a RNFL defect with a disc hemorrhage. Then if you examine, what I want to emphasize, if you examine one eye, then there will be confusion whether to treat or not. But when we examine both the eyes, there is point in treating both the eyes. So always examine both the eyes, not only one eye. And this case, we are following for 15 years. This is a large optic disc with a diffuse thinning with a big cup. So seeing this patient, someone has started anti-glaucoma medication, but then we followed this case for 15 years. There is no change in the structural and functional state. This case presented to us with this much of finding, on looking this pallor, someone will think it's a neuro-ophtha case or something else is there. But this patient gave a history of acute pain and redness, vomiting and blurring of vision and retmo halos. And he was admitted with and given some intravenous injection. And when careful gemioscopy was done, he was found to be case of angle closure glaucoma and PI and dilated fundus photograph. This was the picture. So in a case of PI, you can get this pallor. And the other eye also, he has intermittent bonus and yes, both eyes needed treatment. This eye with PI and medical management, this eye needed because he has cataract combined surgery. And what I want to emphasize, what my previous speaker also has said, one has to look in a small optic disc, not only the color cup. If one looks to the color cup, then one will be confused, it's a 0.3 disc. But this is a contour cup. The bending is here, almost here. It's around 0.7 cupping with a field that is a superior arcuate scotoma. So this patient needs treatment. This patient also, what I want to emphasize, is a shallow cup. Without careful examination, this can be missed. There is a shallow cup, almost the inferior limb is lost with a peripapillary atrophy and a clear cut NFL defect, which is very clearly visible in a red free filter in a green light. And this patient is a normal size optic disc with a disc hemorrhage and a peripapillary atrophy. This case, he presented to us with a routine glass checkup case, but the pressure was around the 20. So, and both eyes has a similar cupping, but one eye has a disc hemorrhage. So this was followed up because the cases with disc hemorrhage, ocular hypertension cases, when they develop disc hemorrhage, the risk of developing to POAG becomes 6 times in univariate analysis. So this disc hemorrhage should be taken care into very carefully. This case is a myopic case with a tessellated fundus with disc hemorrhage, so RNFL could not be commented. So it should be checked with regular follow-up, should be done before thinking anything. But one has to be very careful to differentiate between glaucomatous and non-glaucomatous cupping, which is often very difficult for experienced clinicians. Optic disc excavation with pallor of the remaining neuroretinal rim suggests a cause other than glaucoma. And what are the three considerations optic disc suspect? Optic disc size should be considered along with the CD ratio. Similar cup disc ratio in the family members should be examined. Evaluation of the cup disc ratio in the usual pattern of the 5R rule. Difficult to evaluate the optic nerve in case of tilted disc, high myopia, optic disc, Duchenne, optic nerve coloboma. Increased CD ratio with the disc size and race should be considered. And one method is when a suspect develops from a suspect to a glaucoma, by observing a change, either with a photograph or imaging, one should think for treatment initiation. So key points of considering before treatment initiation, you confirm your diagnosis, because structural assessment is very important. With the neuroimaging techniques, perform structural and functional assessment together. Asymmetry should be looked into. IUT, higher IUT and metrocoupling, and associated risk factors should be second. And document your findings, baseline finding, educate your patient for follow-up. So patients with high risk, to summarize my finding, patients with high risk cases with this suspect, treatment should be considered with IOP reduction of 30%. This suspect with moderate risk with visual field loss should be considered for a observation. If the change increases or risk increases, then one should think for treatment option. This suspect with low risk visual loss, then one should observe, monitor the cases. Last but not the least, one should, before starting treatment, one should consider the possibility of progressive visual loss against the expected life expectancy, treatment related side effects, financial impact, negative effect on the quality of the life and individual. We are treating the patient, not the disease only. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, Dr. Rita. Now we'll go to Dr. J.C. Das. Professor, he's a very senior person and he has to finish within such a short time. Dr. Das, slide.
Thank you, Dr. Sumita, for giving me this chance to. I'm connecting. Is it visible now?
Yeah.
It's starting up, sir.
Oh, yeah. Thank you very much, Professor Sumita, to give me the chance to be a part of this course. And see, all my previous, this is the only, being the last speaker, there is one certain advantage that all the speakers, newer speakers will try to lessen your burden from all aspects. Professor Nanda has covered a lot of things, and Dr. Of course, Sumita has done it, and everybody, right? But before going to the treatment as such, I'll try to consolidate everything and say what should be the modality of treatment for the glaucoma suspects.
Sorry to interrupt, but the PPT is not visible. There's a blank screen which is there. Request you to reach Mama, it. Asuni.
Okay. Asuni. Stop sharing, na?
Asuni.
No, Asuni.
Mm-hmm. Sir, otherwise you can just say it out. You can extempore, give a talk.
All right, I can, but I'll try it. Just give me a few seconds.
Yeah.
Has it come now?
No, it is coming as a blank slide. Black color.
Oh.
So, sir, looking at your expertise.
All right.
I think we can
without
the slide.
All right. All right. What? And in the meantime, I'll just go on talking about it. And by definition, if you talk about the glaucoma suspect, the definition is a case where the clinical findings are suggestive, but they are not confirmatory of the glaucoma. That is what glaucoma suspect stands for. Simply speaking, that the appearance of the optic nerve head and optic nerve fibers and field effects are suggestive of glaucoma in some extent, but are not definitive of glaucomatous changes of optic nerve head. Can you see me now?
No, sir.
Okay.
No, sir, still black.
Right.
Glaucoma, sir, just give an extempore talk, that will be better.
Okay, so, okay, I'm giving it. So glaucoma suspect means, glaucoma suspect may be of any type. Glaucoma suspect may be of IOP suspect, the disc suspect, field suspect, imaging suspect, as well as the primary angle closure suspect. Every aspect has been clearly discussed by previous speakers. But as far as the glaucoma IOP suspect is concerned, any intraocular pressure more than 21 millimeter mercury till the 30-31 millimeter mercury will be called as the ocular hypertension, and the higher intraocular pressure has to be determined by the diagonal variation, not by its only absolute values, but also the number of fluctuations or the degree of fluctuations. One aspect of the higher intraocular pressure more than 30 is not the glaucoma. It is the vascular block that is very important. So keep a watch if the intraocular pressure is more than 30, the increased risk of vascular block in susceptible patient is higher. So we have the intraocular pressure suspects and we have the dissuspects. And the previous speakers have already said about the dissuspects. And I had some photograph to show, but anyway, I can't show it now. And the field suspect, it has been covered, and the imaging suspect has been also covered. But I had few good slides. Unfortunately, it is not coming. Sorry. And but you must be very, very sure that what is the conversion rate, because whole management of the glaucoma suspect will depend how much the conversion rate is from suspicion. That means how many patients are converting from the suspicion to actual open angle glaucoma. As far as the intraocular pressure is concerned, ocular hypertension going into chronic open angle glaucoma or open angle glaucoma is roughly 9.4% in 10 years time. That means if you untreat them, if you don't treat them, the ocular hypertensions, including pressure of 25 to 30, nearly 10% of them will convert into open angle glaucoma in 10 years time. The same type of picture, if you say the angle closure suspects are likely to change into the open angle, likely to change to primary angle closure or even to primary angle closure glaucoma in 10 years time. If you consider the Indian situation, that was a study by Dr. Ravi Thomas and Vellore, that nearly 20% of the angle suspects, primary angle closure suspect, will convert 22% in 5 years, they'll convert into the primary angle closure. And out of that, 25% will switch over to angle closure glaucoma in 5 years' time. There are studies, JAF studies in China, and there are other studies in America. Dr. Manisha has already dealt with it. Their situation, they always consider the acute angle closure as the conversion from the primary angle closure to the angle closure glaucoma. But we are not considering acute angle closure attacks. We are considering the primary angle closure suspect going into chronic angle closures, which is asymptomatic. So in our Indian situation, I'll certainly give more importance to the primary angle closure suspects or even to the primary angle closure compared to any other country. So the JAF study or the American study are not applicable to our Indian situation. But the things are a little different when the changes in the visual field and the imaging in the suspects are concerned. And they will depend on how much risk factor they have. And some speaker have already shown, Dr. Nanda has already shown the risk factors, but intraocular pressure, higher intraocular pressure is a very great risk factor, age, family history, thinner cornea, and moreover the systemic vascular factors like the hypotension or even autoregulatory mechanism failure are very, very important risk factors, along with the sleep apnea and the smoking. So one single risk factor is less important. When there are multiple risk factors, a patient falls into another group of very high risk. There are high risk calculators available. So this will include the OAT study and the European glaucoma studies and the diagnostic innovation glaucoma studies, and have got the mechanism, it will calculate automatically and can predict the 5 years risk factor to convert into the open angle glaucoma. You can always, is available, one can have the calculators, from the market. When to treat.
Sorry to interrupt, sir, but we would have to wind up the session now because everyone would be invited for the inaugural program as of now.
Okay, and okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, all of you all. Thank you for making this session a great success. We are sorry we had to rush in because of the inauguration, which is there at 5:30. So thanks a lot.
Thank you for understanding and expediting the program, and each one of you, heartfelt thanks to everyone. And now I invite you all for the 79th AIOC virtual inaugural program. We conclude the hall now. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you all of you all. Can just close the hall, Sonali?
Sure, sir. We can do that.
Yeah.
Thank you all.
Thank you, everyone. We have to close it. First to close it. Thank you.